The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Welcome to the Fort Report.
I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel columnist and reporter. And as we tape, it rained about an inch last night, which is appropriate because I'm talking today about recent flood and wind and with two people in town who probably know about it more than they care to, Al Mall, Director of Parks and Recreation, Bob Kennedy, Chairman of the Board of Works for the City of Fort Wayne. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you, Kevin. Good to be here.
Thank you. Now, I should point out before we begin, Bob, your job in the context today is to deal with and prevent flooding. Al, as park director, your job is kind of to let it flood all over your property, correct? So Bob had a pretty good run in June with all the flooding we had. We'll talk about that. And Al, not so much. Your parks are still to some degree underwater and with all the damage that implies. So
it hasn't been a joy ride for 3 weeks.
Well, why don't we start, before we begin, we have a few photos that I think will illustrate a little bit about what we've been dealing with, and then we can talk with Al and Bob about all of that. So why don't we run those right now, if we could, and gentlemen, describe them as we begin. Bob, why don't you, I know you know what this is.
Okay, this is our flood control project out in the Woodhurst, Sherwood Terrace area out in Foster Park. Borders Foster Park with the neighborhoods to the east. This project came about after the 2003 flood. Mm-hmm. Back in 2003, we had the flood of record on the St. Mary's River, actually the highest level here in Fort Wayne in history.
Now that open area there is actually closed with a temporary block during flooding, but I wanted to show this. I took the shot from the top of the berm because if you see on the right, the brown area, that's pretty much where the flood water was. And to the left, where the homes are along Sherwood Terrace, remain dry, unlike 2003. Yeah. So why don't we show the next photo? And Al, I know you know what this is.
Yes, during this period, we had water as high, if anybody can visualize, an outfield fence.
This is the same area, by the way, we showed, but with the insert in place.
But to Bob's team's credit, this actually worked, protected the homes. On the other side, though, of course, we lost use of all the baseball diamonds. The water was over the outfield fences at times.
Mm-hmm. And those are the diamonds behind the dike there. Yeah. Okay, next.
Well, that's just a beautiful sight of what Foster Park looks after the water recedes, pretty much mud. Grass is pretty resilient, and with proper seeding and with some good weather, it'll come back, but it's not a real pretty sight now.
And that's not the only park, I should add, that looks like that.
No, I think we have, and I think that's Foster, is that Sweeney?
Okay? That's Foster, I believe.
Yeah, I thought it was. Foster. And Sweeney's looks just the same as people come in on Jefferson or exit the city. They'll notice that both of those, East and West Sweeney, was pretty much looks like a mud bath also. Mm-hmm. Lawton got hit pretty bad, and Krieger. Other parks were some modest problems, but those four parks are the ones that got hit the worst.
Okay,
now we might want to cover the history of the parks and why they were built along the rivers, and they are actually used for flood storage.
Exactly.
That's a good point, Bob. A lot of people don't realize, they say, well, geez, Al, you know, that's nice. The one side looks good and the other side looks terrible. It's the parks. But credit to our founding fathers is they developed parks to be basically almost fish ponds.
Exactly. Yeah,
and that's what, so 30% to 40% of all parklands, we have 86, but 30 to 40% are floodplain. And they're designed to absorb the rainwater, absorb flooding based on principles that were developed at the turn of the century.
With minimal damage to a structure. Well, and we shouldn't go on that point without mentioning Headwaters Park, which is a more recent flood control development, but that was quite exclusively for flood control in addition to all the other recreational activities we now enjoy there.
That's correct.
Exactly. It wasn't impacted this year because the flood was all in the St. Mary's. That's,
well, we'll get to why
okay,
that
sure.
why that
exactly.
was. Let's show the last couple of photos, if we might. And this is back in that area in Foster Park in 2003, correct? Looking toward where the dike is now, but was not at that time, and you see the impact. Bob, maybe you want to talk about that.
Yeah, this is standing on Hartman Road looking to the south. Now there's a flood wall. The ball diamonds are down to the left part of the screen. The golf course is all to the right. And they actually took another picture this year. Mm-hmm. That's the exact, this photo right here, mm-hmm. it's exact, you know, stood in the same area, and you can see all the water. There's an earthen berm to the right, so we kept all the water on the golf course side and protected all those homes.
Good for the homeowners, not so good for Al.
But I think the priority for the city should be where it's going. Mm-hmm. Also, they pump water. They have a system, a program that they actually pump water from the neighborhoods into over the levee into the park.
Okay. Well, Bob, let's go back to the, if people can remember the last two photos we showed.
Sure.
And even back to 1982, which I covered as a journalist, second worst in Fort Wayne history. A lot has happened since then to get to the point where we were in June to have the record June rainfall with relatively little damage. Run us through that, if you would.
Well, back after the 1982 flood, the mayor back then worked with the Army Corps of Engineers, and they came in and designed the major flood. There's 11 miles of protection mm-hmm. the Army Corps built back in the 80s and 90s. They finished up in the mid to late 90s. They finished the project. There were three phases of flood control. And that protects mostly the downtown areas, the Lakeside area, Bloomingdale.
Which is where a lot of the flooding in 82
back in occurred, the 80s, 82 and 85, that's where the mm-hmm. majority of the flooding occurred.
And that was about $50 million.
That was a $50 million project. Since 1982, had some quiet years. 2003, we had a flood on the south part of Fort Wayne, the St. Mary's, mm-hmm. that wasn't included originally in the Army Corps project because it didn't meet the cost. There wasn't enough damage there mm-hmm. during the 82 flood. It was more of a downtown area flood. So after 2003, we looked at, we had a 205 study going with the Army Corps that looked at the Fairfield Ditch in the southern part of the St. Mary. So we continued that, and that's where the first major project was the Woodhurst project. It's a little bit over a mile of protection because mm-hmm. that was the largest area damaged in 2003 and 2005.
And it apparently worked very well.
It worked very well. It's the project was work flawless.
Well, and you did a few other things as well. I mean, you have better advance warning today because of your remote stations.
We have. After 2003, we really changed the way we fight floods in Fort Wayne. 2003, we had a summer flood in July. July 4th, it started the flooding, similar to this year in June. And 18 months later, in January, we had another flood that hit the same homes. So we had several areas that were hit very hard in 2003. 18 months later, they're hit again. So we looked at that and said, we've got to do something locally. We couldn't wait for the federal dollars. It takes too long to get through. We love working with the Army Corps, but it's just too long. We had two floods that close together. So we did several projects. We did a stormwater bond so we could pay for buying out homes, building some projects, and also doing some neighborhood flood, where the neighborhoods flood, some flood damage control in the neighborhoods.
Well, and I wrote down a couple figures you and I talked about before that I think illustrate the impact we're talking about. 15 homes were flooded, roughly, give or take, this year compared to 300 in 2003.
Yeah.
And with the help of a lot of volunteers and employees, you had 75,000 sandbags that you placed, mm-hmm. which sounds like a lot until you figure that in 2003 it was about 250,000.
Exactly.
Now, has any damage estimate been compiled yet, to your knowledge?
Not yet. We're still working with neighborhood code and the building department. They're still looking at some areas that were where homes were damaged. We did use, during a flood fight, we use at least 30 large pumps. I mean, these aren't little utility pumps. These are pumps that have 6-inch discharge, so it's moving millions of gallons of water. So we have pumps. We have clay dikes we put in. Barry and Theme's an area we had to protect with clay this year. Mm-hmm. So we've got a few trouble areas. We're still looking in the future. We're going to look at addressing those areas.
We'll get to the future toward the end. Now, Al, I think you had some maybe preliminary ideas about what the cost of damage was, but also lost revenue with golf and other things. Talk a little bit about that, if you would.
Well, some of our operations, you know, Kevin, are business operations, mm-hmm. and the golf operations are such that if you go back, you refer back to 2003 when we had hit there in the summer, and I was in a different capacity for mm-hmm. the city at that time. We never recovered the business level from that flood. and business patterns of people.
Never ever or that year? So you're still feeling the effect?
We've never had a return to the business levels of that. Now, some of that's due to just trends of golf nationally.
Right.
But also people, you change their business patterns or operating patterns for 4 or 5 months, and not everybody comes back. Mm-hmm. This year, I think, at a minimum, just the revenue loss at the golf operations, probably $150,000, $200,000. So we get double hit. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the restoration of the golf course will be at least another $100,000. So, and I've been pretty public about that. I would think $250,000 is probably a conservative just at the Foster Park operations.
Does insurance cover any of that?
No.
So you've got to find a way to absorb that.
I mean, we'll file a claim, but typically business interruption is in a public entity is tough to claim on the insurance side. But we'll try to file a claim, and working with Bob's people, we'll try to come up with that. But I'm not very optimistic that that's going to, we didn't get anything in 03.
Well, what does that mean? Maybe you can both talk about this in terms of budget moving forward. Do you have reserves you can weather the storm temporarily, or will you have to go to council
for more
funding? I got $5 in my pocket you can have.
In some cases, from the parks perspective, we have some private funds that we can tap, not enough to cover. So where we have trees down and things, and you're going to get into the wind here pretty soon with that storm, but we have some we can tap, but not near enough to handle the cost. And we don't, as Bob said, we don't know what all the costs are at this point.
Well, and if you do that, then that's money you don't have for other things.
Exactly right.
Well, let's talk about the wind, and no politicians intended. But we had, 60-mile-an-hour winds. That one Saturday, it was a lot like a hurricane must feel like, with heavy rain and wind at the same time. Al, let's start with you. I mean, I'm sure your parks were hit very hard again.
Well, the parks, but in our initial focus, since we're responsible for street trees, would be the safety of the citizens. And we, because of the water, because of the ground being so saturated, if you look around town, there's just been trees uprooted. We didn't even have that back 2 years ago when we had the big storm.
Because the soil was so
soil was so soft. Yeah. We had, out of the gate, 40 trees down on homes that were street trees. So we had, our first focus was to get that taken care of. If we did that internally, if we had contracted that out, you want to cost, that would have been $200,000.
Well, and I know several streets were blocked, and even fairly recently, there were still a few that were not open.
In all streets, I will say that at this point, or I'd say 99% open, so that's taking the trees. Now, where we work, we use private contractors, Bob's people help, and of course, Park Department, who's responsible for it. The problem you have, it takes cranes and it takes the proper equipment, regardless of how many people you have. So we had 150 street trees down. We had 100 that are uprooted. We do not handle taking care of the root. We can't handle that. So you have to contract out 100 roots taken care of just on the streets. Parks are a different situation. Another 125 down there.
Well, and I know for years the Park Department would do a regular pruning program, which I'm not sure you're doing anymore for budget reasons.
Well, we've had some budget cutbacks, but we still have a cycle. I mean, our cycle, we'd like to have trees trimmed every 6 to 7 years, and we're probably on a 9-year cycle now. But no, we still have a contract out
there. So that wasn't a major factor, you don't think, in what happened?
No, I don't think so. I mean, we also lost 14,000 trees, which
Those are going to be replaced, or the ones you lost in the wind. Is there a plan to replace those, or
we have the
ones on public property anyway?
We will replace them. We won't replace them all this year, but we have a typical tree planting program, and we try to plant 500 or 1,000 a year. But it's going to be budget related.
Okay. Well, let's look toward the future, and we talked a little bit about it already. But Bob, what still needs to be done in terms of flood control, and did we learn anything this year that might help influence that?
We did. We every flood, every snow, every windstorm's different. So we document it. We have people in the field during the floods, during the storm. So we watch the water levels. It comes across different areas depending on where the rain, what basin the rain hits. So we still have a couple areas out south in the St. Mary's that we want to address. Like we talked about Woodhurst, we were successful there. Winchester Road, we bought out homes and built a levee there to protect a couple neighborhoods. Park Avenue, Waldron Circle, Thompson Avenue. Back after 05, we built a project there. So we've pulled a lot of problems out. We're still working on the Bella Vista area and Prairie Grove, Broadrup, all those streets in there. And right now we're working with doing some engineering with the Army Corps, but right now we're debating on if we delay that project or try to find local funds like we did.
How much money do you think you put all that together? How much are we looking?
You know, the study with the Army Corps for the Bella Vista, it was millions. It was over $10-20 million. It was a big project. We think we might be able to do something locally that won't be as expensive that we can fund locally.
And so, of course, I think we still have 1.1, give or take, coming in theory from the federal government that is still tied up over the Kokomo baseball field, correct?
Yeah, we're hearing that's going to be released here in the next few weeks to a month. We hear that's going to come. And some of those homes are actually in those areas. They're
it's like 18 homes, I think.
Yeah, they're in the junk ditch. Some are in the two on Broad Ripple. So a lot of the areas that flooded, that some of the homes are, you know, on that list. So that'll help. But it's not a solution. It's the homes that are in the lowest areas that we can't protect.
Right.
So it'll be helpful, but it's not a long-term solution.
Well, Al, how long do you think it'll take? You mentioned golf never came back completely. I mean, how long will it take to get the parks back in some kind of shape?
Well, Foster, just speaking specifically on golf operations, I would be surprised if we have any level of golf operations at Foster up before mid-August, and that would be a best-case scenario. So this year, we can probably just say it's in the dumpster, so to speak. As far as going forward and getting the parks cleaned up, our focus first were the streets. We'll start attacking all the trees that are down in the parks, and we'll deal with what areas, you know, to make sure it's safe for people, deal with those first. But as far as restoration of the golf course, that'll take a year.
Will the grass all come back by itself, you think?
Well, not by itself. We'll have to incur, if you talk about costs, probably at Foster Park alone, another $15,000 just in seed. We've kept the greens okay. Fortunately, I didn't lose them. But we'll probably double our seeding throughout the parks this year just because of the flood damage.
Well, and I know when I was out in the Foster Park area, Sherwood, after the flood, I mean, it smelled really bad. So, I mean, there is some health issues that you have to deal with too, correct?
The only cure for that will be some sunshine and some rain, and it'll kill the bacteria. Mm-hmm. But as far as health issues relative to use of it, I mean, we sanitize the pavilions, we sanitize the playground. The playground has to have some work done on it too, because the surfacing there will have to all be removed. And it's a fairly
Is that a product of the CSOs we hear so much about primarily, or would that occur naturally in any flood?
Well, I think when it's been contaminated by the river multiple times, we don't have any choice but to remove it.
It's both. Even ponds that don't have CSOs have E. coli and different bacteria, so it's a combination of both.
Okay. Well, Al, I know you put out a call a few days ago for volunteers from the public. How has that gone to date? How many people do you need? What kind of work can they do? And if they're interested, how can they get involved?
Well, first, you talk about lessons learned. That was a lesson learned from the storm of 2 years ago. We decided to maybe get our volunteer group a little stronger, a little more organized, so that when we have this issue, different people in different neighborhoods take on a specific park. And so we made the appeal, pulled those groups in, but then this the general appeal, it's been surprisingly, I guess not surprisingly, I expected people to jump aboard. We had 18 to 20 high school kids attack Shove Park, take care of that yesterday. We've had about 7 or 8 of the parks people join, and people are calling. We want to make sure we give them specific projects and make sure it's safe for them. We don't want them attacking something that they really aren't equipped to handle. But we'll take anybody who wants to get a 427-6000, give us a call. We'll direct you to a specific project. And if you have a favorite park you want to deal with, let us know and we'll put you to work.
Well, Foster and Sweeney are the two, I think, hardest hit. What other parks need work right now?
Well, we have 86. Every one of them, either through the windstorm, has some type of debris or trees down, or just rubbish that's blown all over the place. And because of our focus of our crews on the streets right now and at working on Foster, every park has work to be done. And basically what we want the citizens to do is just pile things up in a pile and we'll come in and get it.
Well, it'd be a good project for a neighborhood association if there's one.
And they have local parks that they have an attachment to.
Sure. Bob, any idea, you know, in terms of overtime for city employees, how much has been spent today?
We had much more in the flood. We had probably, there was $100,000, $150,000 during the flood alone, just in city utilities and public works, our staff then. Windstorm wasn't quite as much. We worked The whole just one weekend during the windstorm, and we've got a lot of damage to streetlights. We probably had 80 different locations where the trees came down on streetlights, and I'm in charge of all that. So we're working to get those back up and running here.
Any additional appropriation going to have to be sought from council at this point?
Well, as we accumulate the cost, we're going to have to give that some thought. Right now, we don't know what the amount is, and a lot of that will be driven by how much we have to contract out, and at this point, we don't know what that is.
Okay. Well, one question I had from a reader, and I think, Al, maybe you can begin to talk about this. We're hearing a lot about riverfront development. Clearly, rivers flood, as they just did. What, if any, impact do you think the flood we just had will have or should have on the planning process? Did it show us anything we're not doing properly that maybe we should rethink while there's still time? Or is it showing us, yeah, you know, we were pretty much right?
Well, I think I'm on that committee, and I would think anytime you would take any type of riverfront development as a process, as a major process going forward, including in Fort Wayne, Indiana, that would have been on the table out of the gate, and it was. So any type of design, any type of engineering work's done, that's going to take that into taking that into account on how the bank handles the you know, basically the historic flood levels, and that's all taken into account. Again, we're just in the early stages, and I don't think that dampens the outlook. I don't think that hurts the momentum at all, because that was all known commodity going in. It's just we got the timing was about it's about a perfect storm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well,
the rivers, they don't only flood in Fort Wayne, they flood in other cities too.
Exactly.
And many other cities all around the world have built these riverfront projects, and just part of the engineering process we have to go through.
But that is one other thing that will probably fall on the Parks Department eventually, maintenance and repair and cleanup after a flood, right?
Well, that could be, or it could be a separate commission or whatever. At this point, that hasn't been determined, but I would think maintenance would logically, any type of green space as it affects, would be a park function, sure.
Mm-hmm. So are we prepared for the next flood, do you think, Bob?
Always. Yep, our floods can occur anytime, and like I showed you before, we have technology at our fingertips where we can watch the rainfall and the river gauges. So 24 hours a day, we monitor the weather, whether it's raining or snowing or windstorms.
Sorry, go ahead, Al.
Well, down in Bob's war room, it is like you'd think you're in the Department of Defense. He's got incredible technology going. It's almost a second-to-second.
Well, talk a little bit about the technology. I think we kind of gave that short shrift, but I mean, you're really dealing now in real time with information that in 82 you simply didn't have.
Back in the 80s, not even up through the 2003 flood, we had to manually go out and check the river gauge levels. We had to send someone out during the pouring rainstorms, during the flood. They'd manually check the gauges. Now we have them, they're on our phones. I mean, it's an app on the phone it's free. It's Fort Wayne River Watch. You can get it up on the App Store. It's free on Apple, that monitors it. It's real time on 30 different rain gauges in Fort Wayne all the way to Rockford, Ohio, and the same with the river gauges.
And in the old days, your only gauge, I think, was in Decatur, correct?
Yeah. The river gauges back in 03, before 2003, the National Weather Service projected all the crests of the rivers off one gauge. That was on the Maumee River. And after the 03 floods, like, we need a flood in Fort Wayne. That's one of the first things we did. Now we have gauges on all the rivers that the National Weather Service, they project the crests on all rivers.
Well, how does that help you in terms of responding, to have information quickly?
Well, we even have a gauge out in the junk ditch area now. So it's something we have at our fingertips. We can watch. Before, we had to try and project the levels from Decatur all the way to Fort Wayne. It's a lot of farm fields. There's miles and miles of farm fields that flood between Decatur and Fort Wayne. So there's really no accurate way to project it. Now we have a flood gauge in the southern part of Fort Wayne, so we can watch the levels as they come up.
And you can divert resources to where they're needed, I would think, more quickly.
Exactly.
Than you could previously.
We even use an HD camera out at Calhoun and Tillman. That's the first intersection that really goes underwater. So we can monitor the river even, you know, from our desktops.
I think after every emergency we've had, and give credit to the mayor here, he gets the team together, let's go through a complete debriefing, and we find issues every time after everyone. But just Bob goes back to 2003, 2005. Mm-hmm. 311 wasn't even here then. Yeah. Now we have a direct communication link. Citizens contact us quickly. We get to try to get out and respond. And at that built, we don't respond in 5 minutes. Yeah. But just the communication of the public's better, the tracking of the system's better. And
have you done the debriefing yet for this one?
We have regular meetings. We have regular meetings ongoing, but we haven't. The final debriefing would be simulating all the cost and how we're going to minimize that going forward.
Any glaring problem that you identified this year that maybe should be addressed, or did things go pretty well?
I think things went pretty well. I mean, we're still looking, and we've got a couple trouble areas like we talked about, the Wayndale area, the Bella Vista area that we're looking at addressing and figuring out if we're going to move those up and do them locally.
Okay. So I don't know what all we could do relative to the golf operations, because we are debating the water. There's not a whole lot we can do. That's exactly the game plan. So,
flooding, we also have a project design under engineering right now, a Berrien theme, where we hauled.
Well, you had the
clay dike
down there.
And now we're down there removing the clay dike as of today.
And then hopefully we won't need it again, right?
We hope not.
Are the flood maps changing because of all the work you've done?
I don't know. It's something where we can only raise the crest a very minute amount by any project we do. So when we do a project, it's always a joint project. We're returning green space, we're buying homes, and we're trying to keep as much green space as possible.
But I mean, the people, say, on Sherwood Terrace who might have had to have flood insurance before, that won't go away for them.
It hasn't gone away yet. We're still working with the feds. We've been working with them since the wall was built out in Woodhurst. And after Katrina, federal government's not, they don't want to take homes out of floodplain, even though.
Right.
We're going to go back to them after this flood. We documented the height, how much freeboard we had in the wall, so we're going to go back at them again and try to get those removed.
All right, well, and hopefully July will be a little drier and sunny, and the grass will start getting green again in Foster Park.
Before the snow falls.
Exactly. Well, gentlemen, I think we have to wrap it up there. I appreciate it. Al Mall, Bob Kennedy. Al, give the number one more time if you want to volunteer.
427-6000. Just give us a ring and we'll pick it up and ask for your help.
Okay, great. Gentlemen, thank you, and thank you all for joining us on the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger. Be sure to check this and other episodes out at www.news-sentinel.com. Thank you.